Good morning. This is Pelham here. I am coming to you from my house, a guest bedroom. Actually, I am nearing the end of my 2-week self-isolation, and while I don't think I've gone crazy yet, I'm probably not the best person to ask. So, I'm stuck in this house. You can't leave your property. I didn't really have any other options besides setting up the studio right here. Now, I recognize the irony of a sermon on embodiment coming to you virtually from a person who's not allowed to have contact with anyone else. But perhaps it's also fitting that we have a sermon on neighborhoods coming to you from my neighborhood. This is the last of our messages on our vision statement, which is a relatively new thing for us here at Grace Chapel. I find it kind of exciting to have this put together. Don't get me wrong, this new statement doesn't really introduce any new ideas, but it does give us language to describe two things: who we are now and who we feel led to become. I'll read the statement again. I know you've heard it a million times, but once more. Grace Chapel is a diverse community united by the love of Christ and called to embody that love in our neighborhoods. It tells us who we are by giving us a fair description, I think, about the nature and activities of our community. You know, basically what we look like, what we do. We're talking about embodying Christ's love in our neighborhood, and yes, we're all about that here at Grace Chapel. I have one of the best jobs in the world because I get to work with people who can help me pull off programs that do just that, embodying Christ's love. We have, you know, ESL and garage sales, drive-throughs, the Alice House Christmas party, basketball camps, the free tutoring program that we hosted in the church this fall, not to mention the youth group hauling vegetables with square roots in Fairview, caroling at the Shannocks on Parkland, or tidying up Mission Mart in Bears Lake. This is great and exciting stuff. We're all about embodying Christ's love in our neighborhood. But it's not a perfect description of us, is it? You know, I hear the objections. Maybe you think, well, we're not that diverse, let's be honest. Or maybe we're not that unified, someone might think. You should hear what that person said about that person. Or maybe you think that we're not constantly really being the loving neighbors like we should be. I mean, after all, do you know what that guy does in his spare time? Anyway, these are all fair objections, hypothetical, of course. But that's why our vision statement has a second purpose beyond merely describing what we're already doing. It actually calls us forward. It describes where we feel that God wants us to be, as Paul described last week. And it describes, I think, where we're going. It gives us, in that sense, a glimpse of the future. You know, who knows where we'll be in a community, as a community, 5, 10, or 25 years, but I think we should expect our community to be more diversified, more united, and living out Christ's love in our neighborhood in even better way than we do now. After all, this vision statement is not just a year old, because this course was actually set a long time ago. It was in the late 90s or early 2000s at Grace Chapel when the people of the church started praying that we would resemble our neighborhoods, that we would become more united over divisive issues, and that we would have a bigger focus on outreach to Clayton Park West. Those prayers have been answered, and here we are today. I believe these prayers will continue to be answered if we keep our eyes on this vision. So, as we examine the last part of our vision statement, we'll be focusing on three words: called, embody, and Neighbourhoods. And we'll have that text from 1 Corinthians 12 accompanying us. Thank you so much, Elizabeth, for reading that. You know, many of us are familiar with that text, the ideas it contains about the body of Christ, and maybe you've heard it so many times that, like me, it can tend to lose some of its oomph, you know, some of its power. But I just pray that we can see it with fresh eyes today, because it contains a mind-blowing idea, one that is too big or cosmic for even us to understand or fully grasp. So tell me, what does it mean that we are the body of Christ? But seriously, what do you actually think that means? As I prepared this message, I actually flip-flopped in my understanding a little bit of what I think this means. At first, I approached it like a metaphor, as in we, the people of God, collectively, you know, doing good work, we're like a body, and that we're all different parts, we all play a role, and we're like Christ's body, and that we continue his ministry by doing Christ-like things. That would be the metaphor approach. And then I thought, well, maybe there's something more to it than purely metaphoric. After all, parts of that passage, 1 Corinthians 12, don't just say that we're like Christ's body, but that we are Christ's body. With the Spirit filling us, we're invited to commune with the Godhead, and there's a sense of oneness there. There's a sense of, in some cosmic or mysterious way, that the church is the way that Christ is working in the world and manifesting his presence on earth. So which one is it? Maybe it's a little bit of both. I'm not sure. I wonder what you think. And if you have any thoughts about it, please let me know. This is a mystery that I'm grappling with right now. And at the very least, let's acknowledge that mystery and walk that path of understanding together. So, you know, with that metaphor or cosmic mystery in mind, let's take a look at our vision statement. The first word I want to focus on is called. What does it mean that this community is called? Well, if we start with this idea of the body of Christ as a reference point, then it's pretty clear what the calling is, isn't it? As a whole, we are to continue the work of Christ on earth. But to flesh that out, there's a mosaic of images throughout the whole story of the Bible that describe this calling using different phrases. And let's just dig into there a little bit. In the beginning, humanity is called to be God's image bearers and to care for creation. Abraham is told that his calling, as well as his descendants, is to bless the nations. And once Israel forms, God calls them to be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. When Jesus comes on the scene, it's clear that he is recruiting people in a movement to bring the kingdom of God on earth. He tells his disciples in his final meal together that the world will know that they are his disciples if they love one another. And he leaves them with foot washing as a powerful symbol of humility and service. And of course, lastly, but not leastly, Paul, in his writings, says that we're given a ministry of reconciliation to join God in his reconciling of all things to himself. I could go on, but these are just some of the images to describe our calling as the people of God. And our community here, Grace Chapel, we fit into that bigger picture of what God has called his people and his church to do. Of course, if you follow the logic of 1 Corinthians 12, each of us has a more specific role to play, a more specific calling also. Within this body, there are hands, there are feet, there are ears and eyes, tongues, you name it. All are different, but as Paul says, in all of them and in everyone is the same God at work. What does it mean that one person is a hand and another a foot? Well, that chapter, 1 Corinthians 12, it does lay out, you know, a list of roles that we can play depending on our abilities, you know, apostles, prophets, teachers, helpers, healers, guides, all this thing. And I certainly don't believe that that list is an exhaustive one. I think the list of gifts or roles is much bigger and much longer. And without naming names, people in our community show me that that list of gifts or roles, it includes such things as fixing a bike so that you can give a bike to a family who needs one, delivering meals to those stuck at home, listening to another as they share their hurts and their struggles, on and on, bookkeeping, hospitality, generosity, construction, marine conservation, writing, gardening, legal aid, video editing, tutoring, baking, lending your truck, taking people shopping, helping people navigate scripture and their understanding of faith. You know, I have names in mind for every single one of those gifts, and you probably can think of multiple people that fit each of those descriptions. A lot of people, though, get tripped up by this idea of God's calling on their life. I want to demystify it with a quote, which I believe is the singular best quote about calling of all time. It's from Frederick Buechner, the author and pastor. Here it is. The place God calls you to is the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet. I'll say it again. The place God calls you to is the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet. So that begs the question, what are you passionate about? What does your community and society or neighborhood need? Put the answer to those questions together, and in a way, you found your calling. How exactly does your gifting play out in God's grand story of reconciliation and justice and blessing? I don't know, but I know you have a place. Our place in the big story isn't often clear at first, but we can, I think, figure it out over time by taking steps of faith and courage. Because your calling, and as a result, our community's calling, is better not thought as one divine, predestined, and ordered plan for your life that you just have to discover. I think it's better thought of as a path that gets laid before you, which is bounded on all sides by your passions and your gifts and your opportunities. Sometimes we're able to see down that path a long way, but sometimes the path is only revealed step by step. I have a short story on that note about calling. So my amazing wife, Allison, is an occupational therapist, and while she is a very good one, sometimes she wonders why and how this is where she finds herself. These are big questions, and time will always tell more, but one of the things that she learned in her OT degree was a very particular skill. She learned many things, but she learned this also: how to establish a reliable yes-no communication strategy with people that are nonverbal. How to talk to people who are nonverbal and let them answer you yes or no. Well, wouldn't you know it? Just last month, as we were visiting her dad in hospital after he'd suffered a stroke, what position did Allison find herself in? So Your dad couldn't talk, couldn't even move. But he wanted to communicate big and important things about life to his family. So Allison figured out a way to communicate for him to communicate to them through eye movements, which, as you can imagine, provided connection and, more importantly, closure. She says that if learning that skill was the only reason that she became an occupational therapist, then all that training was worth it, just for that one moment. Now, this is a small example of calling, something illustrative and something to ponder for the rest of our lives. It doesn't always work out clearly like that, but I think those moments do come to us. Let's move on. In our vision statement, we're called to embody that love. I really like that word, embody. If you were to define embody, what would you say? Normally, it means something like to be an expression of, or to give tangible or visible form to. That's what the dictionary says. So you could say something like, the Toronto Raptors embody a competitive spirit, or that my puppy Heidi is the embodiment of innocence, or trouble, depending on the day. And that's the way we're using embody in our vision statement too. You know, we want to be a community who gives tangible or visible expression to the love of Christ. We want to be Jesus's love represented concretely to the world. Again, that's part of what it means to be the body of Christ. You might say that the body is the physical part of Christ, the flesh and bones, the hand and feet, the part that interacts with the world, and we're given the privilege of playing that role. We're it. We're the body, and we want to embody that love to our neighborhoods. Choosing the word embody in our statement is to draw attention to the physicality of our calling. We're called to take what we know of Christ and how he has worked in our lives and turn it into something real, practical, hands-on. We don't just want to be a community that talks about loving people. We want to be a community who lives it out with our hands, feet, and sweat. We want our love to be, you could say, incarnational. There's something about the word embody which does make me think about the incarnation, the God become man event of Jesus's life and death. In a way, we want to follow his model of moving into the neighborhood, rubbing shoulders with our neighbors and letting our life intersect meaningfully with theirs. Looking again at the vision statement, we see that it says that we're called to embody what? Well, that love, embody that love. And the word that, it points to the previous statement, which is, you know, all of what Paul said last week. That is the unifying and unwavering love of Christ. Think of Christ's love for you. How incomprehensible, how wide and long and high and deep it is. Now, how can we as a community live in such a way that embodies that kind of love? In one translation, John says this: our love for others is our grateful response to the love God first demonstrated to us. Embodying the love of Christ looks like a million different things. I'm sure you don't have to think hard about an example of someone who has embodied Christ's love to you. But we're in a strange time of history, aren't we? How do we embody love when we can't gather together? How do we embody love when all we see of each other is a face on a screen instead of across the dinner table. Embodying love in 2021 certainly demands creativity, to say the least. So I want to share two stories about creative embodiment that inspire me. A community that inspires me is the community of dog walkers in this part of the city. They truly do have each other's backs, or tails in this case. They'll meet every day in the park to let their dogs play with each other, but they'll also share about life naturally and provide support for each other. When one dog attacked another dog in Tremont Park last week, they used a Facebook group called Dogs of Birdland to offer advocacy and support for the family that had been attacked, the family's dog. When the group heard that our puppy Heidi was sick with kidney disease, they organized a Christmas fundraiser in the park for her, and I can't believe it. Now that we're stuck at home in self-isolation, we have other, dog people that come by our front step every day, sometimes spontaneously, to offer to take our two dogs out for walks, which we so appreciate. This is a community that embodies Christ's love. I know it. Second story. Back in 2016, as many of you know, it was a hard time for me and Allison. And one element of that was because of Allison's concussion, there was a sense of isolation and loneliness, compounded by the fact that her friend group had moved away all over the country, all over the world. In fact, one of her closest friends had moved to Japan. And that distance was especially difficult. But that friend happened to be flying through Halifax one day. We met up with her just for one brief evening. She gave Allison a gift, a box. She told her, take this box home with you. Inside the box were dozens of envelopes. Cute little Japanese envelopes that said things like, for a sad day, or for a day when you need a laugh, or for a day when you're feeling crafty. This one says, when you have a cold, or Pelham does, or someone's a little teary and they could use a smile. And of course, each envelope was filled with a different small gift, all of them probably from a Japanese dollar store. The idea was to hold onto this box and open the gifts throughout the year on the appropriate day. It turns out that this friend had been collecting and compiling these gifts for Allison over the course of at least a year. Allison didn't even know, which means that over the course of the year that Allison was feeling lonely or separated from her friends, the truth is that her friend was thinking and caring about her every day. And that gift of the box filled with envelopes and embodied that truth, that she was being thought of and cared for every day. Now that's creative. Lastly, let's look at the word neighborhoods. This was a word we were throwing around a lot at Grace Chapel about 5 years ago, and we're bringing it back. I laugh, actually, because when we first started using this word, we were very clear, and we said, well, this doesn't just mean the neighborhood of the church building, Clayton Park, West. We said something like, of course, we have a special emphasis on this location, but it also includes all the neighborhoods that you live in, wherever that is. That's what we would say. Fast forward to 2021, and most of us are not spending a lot of time in the church neighborhood unless we live there. A lot of us aren't even leaving our own street. I'm not leaving my house. A kilometer or two in each direction, maybe even a few feet, and that's pretty much it for some of us. The pandemic has brought our local neighborhood into clearer focus than ever before. So we use neighborhoods broadly here, in a sense that is plural and particular to you. It means anywhere that you spend time regularly, any community that you're a part of the sphere of your relationships and influence. For a lot of us, that's our workplace. For others, it's a classroom, school. For almost all of us these days, our neighborhood is those that we share a Zoom room with a couple times a week. But, wherever ordinary, run-of-the-mill, hardly interesting place that you find yourself in, that place is sacred because God is in that place and that is the place for you in that moment. Wherever you find yourself, in a mysterious way, God has a reason for you to be there. That reason is love, growth, you know, justice, beauty, peace. While that might sound obvious or cliche, if we really adopt that mindset, it's a paradigm shift. In every situation that you find yourself in, that situation is a meaningful one, with opportunity and value because Christ is in that moment. The Spirit is imbuing your actions with power and meaning, and the work of the kingdom can happen, perhaps invisibly, at that very time. How can you live in a way so that the people in your neighborhood, virtual or otherwise, feel loved by your presence? Of course, many of you know, we just spent a month in Ottawa, and I marveled at the love of the neighborhood there. On North Riverside Drive, 30 minutes south of the city, lives a whole community who cares for each other so deeply, and I'm not sure they even really realize it. When we were there for about 40 days, there wasn't a day that went by without one, two, or three people or families stopping by to drop off a home-cooked meal, a box of cookies, or some flowers. Every single day, the love was so tangible, so consistent. In a time when Allison's family was hurting, those neighbors really pulled through. In this day and age, I feel like a neighborhood that cares for each other like that is kind of rare. But it doesn't have to be. We have a vision. And it includes every one of us. We're walking a sacred road, paved with ordinary moments and filled with great possibility. We're going to start reading the Gospel of Mark next week. And Jesus will ask again and again a question that I think we need to hear today when we think about our vision statement. Do we have eyes to see? Do we have ears to hear? As we gather on Zoom right after the service, I'll leave you with a few questions to discuss, and I really look forward to hearing the answers. Number one, if you think broadly, where are your neighborhoods? When have you seen love embodied creatively there this past year? Number two, how do you feel led to love your neighborhood? Thank you for being with me today. It's a great pleasure, and I look forward to chatting with you in a couple minutes. Take care.